to 6 p.m. Your call is free and confidential. Next week, Panorama has an exclusive report on British General Sir Michael Rose as he completes his mission as commander of the UN forces in Bosnia. The BBC's foreign affairs editor John Simpson travels with him to scenes of some of the worst fighting.
They seemed like perfect neighbours in the perfect street, but when a TV programme began to dig up their gardens, they unearthed a nasty surprise.
This is a murder investigation, Mr. Williams, murder.
It looked like someone living. But I don't know. Asleep. Under the ground.
One to puzzle the panel of gardeners question time. The Plant is Friday at 9:30 on BBC One.
In our quietest and loneliest moments, there is a time we all dread.
One day it's all summer and fun, and the next...
When despite all our reason...
Is it about me, or is it about you?
All our cool-headed logic...
They haunt him, the men he lost.
We simply submit to cold-hearted terror.
It's me! It's me!
That time is here.
Don't touch me, please.
That time is now. Ghosts. Tales to Chill the Blood, Saturdays at 9:15 on BBC One.
Feeling the violent sting of Anthony Quinn's retribution, Kevin Costner channels his anger and hate to exact a dreadful revenge. That's the film in half an hour. Another major star for BBC One now, Hollywood golden boy Tom Cruise, talks about why he turned villain. A Film 95 special with Barry Norman.
Tonight, I'll be talking to Tom Cruise, who at 32 is the biggest young star in Hollywood. Not necessarily the tallest, but undoubtedly the biggest, thanks largely to his presence in the cast. His latest film, Interview with the Vampire, took more than $30 million on its first weekend in America, and this week it opens in Britain. In what is an unashamedly homoerotic piece of gothic fantasy, Cruise is cast very much against type as an amusing, charming, but sadistic vampire. It's not the biggest role, that goes to Brad Pitt, but the film is at its best when Cruise is on the screen. Ironic that, because initially Anne Rice, who wrote the script from her own novel, had violent objections to his casting. Is it, though, worth seeing? Well, yes, it is. The story does tend to meander somewhat inconsequentially, but it's visually and stylistically stunning and superbly directed by Neil Jordan. While Cruise proves yet again that far from being just a pretty face, he's becoming a highly accomplished actor. Get involved with Interview with a Vampire in the first place?
Well, I was in Australia. I just finished the firm. The firm was being released. I was taking a break with my wife and my baby, and they sent me the script, and Neil Jordan was interested in having me play Lestat. So I read it, and I said, I'd love to play this great movie. You know, I read the script and thought it was extraordinary. And then I flew back. I was on my way back to the States, and I met with Neil.
You say you were asked to play Lestat, but when you counted the lines,
Brad Pitt's part is a lot bigger than yours. Now, presumably you'd have had the choice if you wanted to play Louis. You could have done. But you chose Lestat?
Yeah, I like Brad. I didn't want to put him out of a job, you know? You know what I mean? Kind of. But if someone has more lines than me or a bigger role, that's never a reason for me to do a film or not do a film. I've always felt, you know, I read something and I either, you know, I find it engaging and I want to make it or I don't. And I thought all the characters were magnificent, and certainly Lestat, I was excited to play. I'd never played anything like it, and I'd wondered, you know, what can I do with it? You know, I didn't know how it was going to go, but I felt that I had something to contribute to that role in particular.
And it was the best role, actually. There's no doubt about it. Because it's the only one with humor, with a lot of humor.
Well, you know, Neil and I really worked on the humor after I'd gotten it.
Let me kiss her better.
Claudia! Claudia! Now, who will we get to finish your dress? This will practice. Remember, give him into a poem.
Okay, I mean, you're in place, Neil Jordan's in place, Brad Pitt's
Brad's
in place.
There.
And then the controversy starts. What was that all about? Because, I mean, Anne Rice, as far as one can gather, was deeply unhappy about it, and then she saw the film, and she took out this full-page ad and said that she was virtually orgasmically happy now. But what was it all about in the first place?
You know, I think here's a woman who, the book was written at a time, she'd lost her daughter, I guess back in 1973 or 74, and to leukemia. And then she wrote this book, Interview with a Vampire, and I think that she so loved this story and these characters that, you know, when she'd waited so long for it to get made, that it meant a great deal to her. But she was definitely very unhappy with my casting. And, you know, I can understand from her point of view, thinking that's not the blonde-haired, blue-eyed Lestat. She was talking even physically, you know. And the problem was I never had a chance to discuss with her what I was going to do in terms of, you know, people don't understand what you do with acting. Sure. And creating characters. You lose weight, you get the blonde hair, you get the contacts, and you work on the character and find that emotional foundation to allow that character to breathe.
Have you spoken to Anne Rice at all since the film was made?
Yeah, I spoke to her. She actually, after she saw the film, David Geffen, the producer, called me and said, Anne Rice just saw the movie, and, I think you should call her. I said, okay, you know, and I called her, and, you know, I was very nervous. I was thinking, yeah, what did she, you know, think of the movie? And she loved it, and in particular, you know, the stat she was very pleased with. And
did she apologize for the things she said earlier?
You know, I didn't ask for her to apologize. I think the very fact that...
I thought she might have volunteered one.
No, I think in her own way she certainly did, you know. I mean, she took out those ads on her own, and I think that was an apology.
But were you at all worried about taking the role? Because, I mean, to a large extent, your following, and you have a huge following, consists of young women who think you are the greatest thing since the invention of the wheel. And now you're turning up in this extremely homoerotic role. I mean, did you not think this could alienate some of these young women?
You know, image is something that kind of... I can't control what people are going to think, what they're going to say, what they're going to write. I just know what material I like. I'm not very good at thinking of myself in third person. You know what I mean? So that has never been an issue with me in terms of, well, what are other people going to think when I play this character, or will I lose an audience? I mean, not every picture I do is for every audience. You know, each picture is very different, and maybe some people will come out and see it, I don't know, because I'm in it, but I think if, you know, you work hard, you make a good movie, people will come see it, you know.
But the homoerotic undertone, is that stronger in the film than it was in the book? I've not read the book.
With vampires, it's not about being male or female. I think, you know, it certainly can be looked at as that metaphor, and audiences will walk away with, you know, however they interpret it, whatever their life experience is, whatever, you know. I mean, you know, and I'm not going to tell people what the movie is for them. They can decide for themselves. That's the fun of being an audience.
In many ways, Lestat is about as unpleasant a guy as you've ever played, isn't it? I mean, normally you are the hero.
From a human point of view, he's quite unpleasant. But, you know, the snake looks at the field mouse and that's, you know, that's his livelihood. You know, that's how he's going to live. So for a vampire, it's not, I mean, Lestat is doing what he is supposed to do. He's a vampire, you know. And he does enjoy it quite, you know. He enjoys what he does.
Your friend has no head for wine.
Don't worry. I can warm that cold skin of yours better than she can.
Do you think so?
Why? You're warm now.
But the price is high. Your pretty friend, I exhausted her. So soft. I can see you lying on a bed of satin.
I was clearly wrong if I thought that the role would alienate your fans because, I mean, the film had one of the biggest openings of all time, didn't it? $38 million in one weekend.
But I don't know what is going to make money, what's not going to make money, you know? I just know what I like, and I don't think anyone can predict that. It's just a matter of, you know.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, you are one of the very few people, and you must know this, who can really open a movie big.
I find movies to be extraordinary to make, and it takes, you know, so much time and energy, and, you know, it's exhausting, you know. I mean, anyone you talk to, you know, it's a lot of work and dedication, and it's something that I enjoy very much. I'm not complaining about it. I love what I do, and I love the fact that I'm able to do it. But so I choose material that really interests me, you know, because I can't predict it.
No, it's very interesting. Just before A Few Good Men opened, I was talking to Rob Reiner, and he expected you to open that film. He didn't expect Jack Nicholson to open it. He certainly didn't expect Demi Moore to open it. And what he actually said to me was that if, because of Tom, that film takes less than $15-20 million in its first weekend, I'm going to send men round to his house to get the feedback and hurt him. You know? And that's what he said.
Did he?
Yeah. But this puts a big responsibility on you, doesn't it? I mean, you must be aware of that.
Why are you so afraid to be a lawyer? Were Daddy's expectations really that high?
Oh, please, spare me the psychobabble father bullshit. Dawson and Downey will have their day in court, but they'll have it with another lawyer.
Another lawyer won't be good enough. They need you. You know how to win. You know they have a case, and you know how to win. If you walk away from this now, you've sealed their fate.
Their fate was sealed the moment Santiago died.
Do you believe they have a case?
You and Dawson, you both live in the same dream world. It doesn't matter what I believe. It only matters what I can prove. So please, don't tell me what I know and don't know. I know the law.
You can't be unaware of the fact that as soon as you're in a movie, people expect it to be big box office.
Yeah, sure they do. But
and that must be worrying to an extent.
It'll only really become worrying when I stop getting, you know, the movie offers. Then it'll be worrying to me. You know, what I'm saying is I can't base a decision on making a movie based on that. Yeah, do you want to know something? I want my movie to open up huge. I want every movie, you know, to do well and open well. But and yeah, it's a pressure. You know, either you're nervous before the movie opens, and it's a very competitive marketplace. I want the studio to make its money back. You know, you know, they were not kind enough to give me the money to go make the movie. You know, I feel a responsibility to, you know, make it worthwhile for everyone.
Well, it's bottom of the ninth. The score is tied. It's time for the big one.
You up for this one, Maverick?
Just a walk in the park, Kazansky.
Contact. Multiple bogeys. 1-6-5. 2 miles. Looks like they're going away from us.
Oh, I see him. Tally-ho, right 2 o'clock. I'm in.
I'm in.
Am I right in detecting a kind of pattern in your career? Because you did Top Gun, you know, which was real action adventure for the teeny boppers, basically, followed by The Colour of Money with Paul Newman, which, without wishing to sound patronising, I must say, really made me sit up because it was the first time I realised how well you could act. Then you did Cocktail, then you did Rain Man, and again, oh, this is buttering you up like mad, but I think you should have got the Oscar, not Dustin Hoffman. And then you did Ball on the 4th of July. Now, is there a pattern? You know, one for the teeny boppers, one for me.
No, they're all for me.
They're all for me. Yeah, well, that's even better.
You know, it just kind of has worked out that way.
Back at the beginning of the 80s, you were rightly or wrongly lumped together with the Brat Pack, you know, people like Rob Lowe and Matt Dillon and Patrick Swayze and C. Howell Thomas, whatever happened to him, I don't know. Now, you are just about the biggest star in Hollywood, and they are not. So what happened? It can't have been just sheer luck, can it?
I don't know, maybe you can answer that better than I can. I really, you know, I don't know. I really don't.
Did you get him?
It never happened to good manners. I mean, the simple custom of knocking on the door before entering.
The gold. Jeez, I'd give my right nut for those Oakleys.
Does a major live at this address?
Oh, can I touch him? Please, please, huh?
Oh, man, I can't believe it. We are going to command the best regiment this school has ever seen.
Damn well said. In honor of this auspicious occasion, Major Morland, your presence is requested in the hallway.
Taps was not at all a bad part. And then there was Losing It, which I think you've described as your cable classic. You know?
Yes,
I mean, these were not necessarily great movies, right? Risky Business helped.
Yeah. Well, Taps was a very good role for a young actor for me to play, you know. To have the opportunity to just work when you're a young actor like that and learn on the job is... I mean, that was amazing, you know. I mean, I learned a lot, and no matter how good or bad the film was, I always walked away with something that I learned and that that I could take to the next one.
1986 seems to have been a kind of pivotal year because there was Top Gun and then The Colour of Money, and you were holding your own with Paul Newman.
That was exciting to work with Newman.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't believe when I got it, you know. I was talking on the phone with Scorsese, and I was going to be in a movie with Paul Newman. You're right, it was an extraordinary year for me.
The guy at the end of the bar, in a black suit. He's been hustling that broad for half an hour. He's going to throw in the towel in 30 seconds for a buck.
You got it. Starting now. 10 seconds.
What do you mean, Rich can be arranged?
25, 26, 27, 28. Guess the news. You lose.
And I just missed it by a couple of seconds.
You want to opt to bet?
Yeah.
Check for the meal size. I leave with her in 2 minutes.
Okay, ready, go. Now, I'm counting.
Every now and again, you co-star with a very distinguished and older actor, Paul Newman, Dustin Hoffman, Jack Nicholson, Gene Hackman.
I mean, I never thought that would ever happen to me. I never thought that I would. I mean, you know, You tell a kid 19 years old you're going to work with Paul Newman in a year and a half, and then you're going to work with Dustin Hoffman and Bobby Duvall and Gene Hackman, my God, Jack Nicholson.
Yeah.
I mean, for, you know, it's so hard to find scripts in the first place, and then to have the opportunity to work with these, you know, that I sat in the dark theaters as a child, you know, watching these performances and you know, that I've seen over in video hundreds of times and just been amazed at what they've done, and now to actually get to see them work. And if I may say, the extraordinary thing about that is that as much as I admired them in seeing their movies, to see them work on a character like this, it makes you, it made me admire them even that much more, you know, in terms of what they've accomplished with performance. You know, it was staggering, you know, at times, thinking, you know, where did that come from? How did they think of that? You know, and each one of them works totally different, you know, and so, I mean, those are all highlights for me as an actor.
You must have had a pretty close rapport, for instance, with Hoffman on Rain Man.
Yeah, we worked on that for almost 2 years before we did it. I saw him develop his character and really stick by the limitations of the reality of autism. And it was amazing watching him come up with that character and work that character. He's working with this young actor. He's very smart about movies and performance. He was incredibly generous with me in those scenes. You know, it was amazing watching him develop that role.
Would you look at that? 1957 Studebaker Goldenhawk. 0 to 60 in under 8 seconds. 275 supercharged horsepower into that hood. That's beautiful.
Of course, I'm an excellent driver.
You know how to drive?
Yeah.
When did you drive?
Of course, I drove the Buick on the driveway when my dad came to Walbrook.
Is Dad in the car? Is Dad in the car, Ray?
Yeah.
He let you drive the Buick?
Yeah, slow on the driveway.
Well, we'll have to let you drive sometime.
Raymond! You never, never touch the steering wheel when I'm driving. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Do you hear me?
Of course, I don't have my underwear.
What?
I'm definitely not wearing my underwear.
What are you talking about? I gave you a fresh pair of mine this morning.
No, not my underwear.
It was actually amazing watching the both of you because, I mean, his character had to stay the same all the way through. And yours grew.
Yes.
Have you considered that two of your eminent co-stars, Newman and Hoffman, have won Oscars and you haven't? Hardly seems fair.
I know, but as they remind me, you know, they weren't even started when at the age I am now.
I also think that, you know, I can't see how an Oscar's going to make your career much better at the moment. Would it?
I'd love to have one, you know. But, I mean, honestly, it won't change in terms of the movies I'm going to make or anything else. But it'd be great to have an Oscar. You know, it'd be, I think, you know, you're an actor, you're making movies, you cannot help but think of that, you know.
Well, I just think you're in with a strong chance of a nomination this time around, aren't you?
I really don't know.
There's not much else you can say, really.
Yeah, I know. What else can I say? You know?
But, the only nomination you've had, of course, was for Born on the 4th of July.
Yes.
And that too, that was presumably a kind of another step forward, because only there you started off being the young, good-looking Tom Cruise every woman knows and loves, and then you gradually got older, and there was definite progression in the character there too, wasn't there?
Yeah. Yeah, looking back, yeah, that really was. I mean, it was a great role and a powerful story. Mm. Yeah, definitely.
I serve my country, and I don't want you to feel sorry for me. Do not shed a tear. I have my hands, my eyes, my ears. I have my heart, and I have what I feel. I have what I feel is an unquenchable,
Have you considered that these people that you used to sit and watch in the cinema, and then you now you say, wow, I'm actually making a movie with these people, they are probably saying, wow, I've been asked to make a movie with Tom Cruise.
Oh, shit.
Well, come
on.
I
doubt that.
Hey, a few good men happened because you were in it. The Firm happened because you were in it. Not in the first case because Jack Nicholson was there, nor in the second case because Hackman was there. I mean, they wouldn't have been there if you had said no to that film.
Yeah, but I think my oh my god was way beyond their oh my god, you know.
But it is a fact. I mean, you must be one of the most important players in Hollywood at the moment.
I mean, yeah, I can at this stage of my career, I have the ability to get movies made. Yeah,
is that nice? That sense of power.
Power is not something I really was ever interested in or thought about. I just want to be able to make movies. So it's very nice that this is here, that I can go make movies. And that's what's great for me, that people want to work with me, and that I have the ability to get a movie made. And it's a real luxury at this stage, you know, and one that...
For sure.
You know, that I want to take care of, but also I want to, you know, enjoy it. With certain sequences, we can spend a little bit more money on it and, you know, to make it, you know, that much better, hopefully. And so that's a good feeling, you know.
Yeah, that's what the clout does for you, really, isn't it?
It does give you room, you know, to a certain degree to be able to make the kind of movies you want to make. And allow you to take some chances and to to spend that, you know, if you want to spend money on a scene, a little extra money or locations or something that you feel it could heighten the story or the character. You really you allow that. I tell you the really good thing, the best thing about it is that I found is that sometimes if things don't work, a lot of times we have the ability to go back and. Every movie I've done, I've always done reshoots on things, which is a great luxury, because always, you know, you can work on the script and you edit the movie and you look at it. There's always something that you can make better or clarify or and to have that luxury is fantastic.
What led you to law school? I can't remember.
Sure you can, counselor.
I was a delivery boy for a pizza parlor, and one day the owner got a notice from the IRS. He was an immigrant, didn't know much English, even less about withholding tax, and he went bankrupt, lost his store. It was the first time I thought of being a lawyer.
In other words, you're an idealist.
I don't know any tax lawyer who's an idealist. When he lost his store, I lost my job. That scared me.
Being out of work?
No. What the government can do to anybody. What about you? What led you to law school?
So far back, I don't think I can remember.
Sure you can, counselor.
I used to caddy for young lawyers off from work on weekdays and their wives. I'd look at those long tan legs and just knew I had to be a lawyer. The wives had long tan legs, too. Alice, another martini, please.
So we're not a couple of idealists?
Heaven forbid.
So the next step, presumably, is to direct your own films.
You know, I did a thing for Sidney Pollack. I did, The Fallen Angel, this Fallen Angel series. And I enjoyed that, you know. Sidney kind of talked me into doing that. And he said, you know, what story, you know, if you were going to direct something for me, what story would you like to do? So I kind of read all these short stories. I said, well, you know, I like to do The Frightening Frame. It's just different, you know. It's got a humor and got a different Alec Thompson. So I ended up doing that, and as a feature film, I don't have a piece of material yet, but I definitely, you know, before it's all said and done, I'd like to direct something. I don't want to just direct all my own stuff forever, because it's fun working with other directors, you know, and actors.
And in the meantime, is there likely to be a sequel to The Vampire? And if there is, are you going to be in it?
I don't know. I know they want to do one, but I haven't, Neil's going to write a script and then we'll read it. I've never done a sequel before, just because I never felt that I didn't know what to do with the character, you know, it couldn't evolve anywhere. But the enigmatic Lestat, I think there's there could be, you know, I think it could, the second one could be very interesting, and you could take the character to a different place. So that's the only way I'd say to them, look, write it, I'll entertain it, let's see.
Well, in the meantime, I look forward to your Oscar nomination for the first one.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year, storing many men's soul and faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Me, damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate.
Tuesday night movie action. From the windswept cliffs of Ireland to the plains of the American Wild West, Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman star in Far and Away, tomorrow, 9:30 on BBC One.
Once upon a time,